I'm Dr. Ruth Jones, a Mishap Investigation Specialist for the NASA Safety Center. I have been with NASA for 21 years. 16 years of those I've been with Marshall Space Flight Center, and 5 years with the NASA Safety Center. I received my Bachelor of Science degree in Physics from the University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff, where I was the first female to receive a Bachelor of Science degree in Physics from that university. I received my Master's and PhD in Physics Material Science from Alabama A&M University, where I was the second African-American female to receive a PhD in the state of Alabama. Being an African-American female was one of the challenges that I had because throughout my educational career, I've been the only female. And going to HBCU really helped that because I was surrounded with people of my color. So having a PhD in physics is a male-dominated field. So Alabama A&M University kind of embraced me as a family. And it kind of gave me role models to look up to and people to interact with. So the experience was very great. And that's when I got on with the career and educational department. And I did a graduate co-op with NASA. And that's how I started my NASA career, through the graduate co-op program. As far as my STEM education, I kind of stumbled upon STEM because when I was in high school, I did not want to go to college. I actually wanted to go to the military. My dad was military, he was Army. And he said if he could do it all over again, he would go to the Air Force. And so since my parents were taking care of two of my cousins, I didn't want to have put them through a financial burden. So I wanted to go to the military so I can go to school for free. But due to a medical condition, I could not go to the military. So looking at the opportunities in my hometown, which are very limited, I knew then that I had to get an education. So that's when I decided to go to the University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff. But initially, I was an accounting major. And I only majored in accounting because I wanted to enjoy the college life, and I knew that accounting was easy. And my college algebra professor, Dr. Mia, he realized and saw that I had the potential to go further in mathematics and science. So he persuaded me to change my major to physics. Initially, I was hesitant about it because I was like, hey, this is going to cramp my style and enjoying the college life and receiving my Bachelor of Science degree with honors. But after I took some of the accounting classes, they weren't challenging enough for me, so that's when I decided to change my major to physics. However, Dr. Mia failed to tell me that I would be the only physics major on campus. So being the only physics major on campus, half of my classes, well, my upper-level physics courses was just me and Dr. Mia. So that taught me, you know, how to become more disciplined and to manage my time wisely. So just to sum it up in a nutshell, I did graduate with honors, and I did enjoy my college life at the same time. Okay, I see the state of African-American STEM education. Right now, we're in a state where it doesn't really exist. And that's due to lack of role models and mentors. Mostly African Americans, we gravitate towards the sports and businesses because that's where the money is. No one really sees how science is in everyday life. So therefore we have that lack of role models and mentors in that field. And also due to lack of funding for the schools in African American communities. They don't have the up-to-date laboratories. And some of the schools, they don't really have like AP physics or AP calculus. They give you the basic and the minimum. So therefore, students don't really get a chance to go to their highest potential. So those are some of the challenges that I see within the African-American community as far as in the STEM education. Image is also another challenge that I see in the African-American community with the STEM education, because no one wants to be seen as a nerd or a geek or goofy. And that's mostly what you see when you Google scientists or engineers. You're mostly going to see a geek or a nerd, and mostly they're white males. So we don't really see ourselves in those images. We see ourselves as being an athlete or an entertainer. So we have to change that image and let them know that African Americans can be smart and sexy, or they can be handsome and smart. But we need to make sure we have enough role models in order to display that image. Until we get enough role models to go out and illustrate that, the students will not really gravitate towards the STEM education. And also we need to have teachers that will challenge these students. And when they see that they have the potential in those math and science classes, we need to make sure that we encourage them to go into those fields instead of saying, well, no, you don't need to take physics because that's too hard, or, you know, you have to graduate in order to pass this class. So we need to encourage them to take those classes and challenge them more so than just discouraging them to take the sciences. And also, another reason why African Americans don't really get into the STEM education, because we think it is hard. And we always want something easy. And I know when I went to college, I majored in accounting at first. It wasn't because I thought that physics was hard. I just knew that accounting was easier, because I took physics and accounting in college, I mean, high school, and I love them both. But just making that choice between one or two, going to college, I just figured, hey, I'll just major in accounting. That way I can enjoy this college life and get my grades done. But I never thought that, well, I don't want to do it because it's hard. But some people and some students don't want to get into the STEM education because they think it's very hard. And if they have that foundation early, then they can build on that foundation and it won't be as hard because they feel more comfortable taking those classes. But until then, if they don't take those classes early, then they kind of disappear from the math and sciences. Growing up in a small town like West Helena, we don't really have the NASA in order to make us gravitate toward the sciences. And it doesn't give us that self-esteem that we need. So my first graduate co-op here at NASA was very, very embracing, because I actually got it. When I first came, I was nervous because I didn't think that my university or my hometown had prepared me for such a big job. But once I got here, I mean, they knew, or I knew as much as they did, and I learned from them. I'm never too bold or too shy to say if I don't know anything. So I'm always good at asking questions. So coming across Dr. Frazier early on in my career, he kind of molded me as far as what to, you know, how to ask questions and how to go about doing things. So that really helped my career early on, because that boosted my self-esteem, boosted my self-confidence. But I guess the challenges that I see here at NASA is, for one, I'm a double minority. I'm Black and then I'm a female. Kind of like a triple minority, because I'm also young. Most of the people that I work with are people who actually could be my parents. They're a lot older than I am. So I embraced that early on. When I first came, I worked with Dr. Lahosky, and he was like a well-known scientist, but he was old, but he knew his stuff. And I really enjoyed working with him and being in a lot of the meetings. Sometimes I'll be the only female in the meeting, and 9 times out of 10, I'll be the only Black in the meeting. So when I look around, I'm just like, wow. You know, I was like awed, because I was in the room full of well-known scientists. And if I could sit at a table with them, I was like, wow, I must really be good. But I didn't take it as an arrogant way. I just took it as a way to learn from them. So it taught me to be humble, because I work with a lot of well-known people and people who've written books, and they do a lot of talks. They have their own shows. So that taught me how to become more humble and not afraid to ask questions. But during that time, what I did realize is that no matter what your color is, no matter what your gender is, it matters what's in your head. You know, education, I say it all the time, it's like Coca-Cola. It is the real thing. Education is like scotch tape. You can't see it, but you know it's there. But more importantly, education is like American Express. You can never leave home without it. And with that being said, what's in my head, nobody can take that away from me. And I know later on in my career, I've gotten challenges about my PhD coming from a historically Black college university. And some people don't look at getting a PhD from Alabama A&M University as equal to getting a PhD from Auburn or Alabama. So that, I had to prove myself that my knowledge is just as good as the knowledge from Alabama or Auburn. But a lot of people don't see that. They look at the HBCUs, they're not equipping their students properly, because we don't have the state-of-the-art equipment. But we have some of the best educators there, the best professors, and these professors are well known. And I've gotten that knowledge from them, and it's helped me to increase my career here at NASA. And I've been moving up and up, and that's because of my humble experiences and also the embracing and family embracing that I got from my HBCU professors and my mentors here at NASA as well. Since this is a STEM education, and, you know, I've changed the acronym from STEM to my own STEM. So I think we need to STEM for STEM. And what I mean by that, the STEM that I came up with acronym is support our communities in education. So we need to start giving back to our education for the ones who have made it out and have good education, good jobs. We need to go back to those communities and serve as role models and give little projects to show the students that, you know, STEM is the way to go. My hometown, West Helena, is very small. And I go back and give educational tours or educational camps at my former schools, high school through elementary, well, elementary through high school. And the students look at me as I'm some type of superstar. But I tell them that I came from the same community as they did. And if I could do it, they can too. But they need to see more of us in order to get that confidence and build their self-esteem that they can do it. And the T would be, we need to talk about how STEM is related to everyday life. When I was in high school, my college algebra teacher, Mr. Ernest Simpson, he would take off like 10 points if you left off the negative sign of a problem. And I'm just like, it's just a negative sign. I got the problem, right? I just forgot to bring down the negative sign. And the first thing he would say, I was in the ninth grade, and I'll never forget this. He said, that could have been the cause of the space shuttle blowing up. But you know, I'm in the ninth grade. I'm just like, oh, Ms. Simpson, now you're just taking it too far. I want, you know, my points. But he looked at it like, this is real life. And you have to be very meticulous and very careful when you do your mathematics. So I think we as a community, we need to talk about how STEM relates to everyday life. And then the E, we need to expose the students early so that they can embrace it early on, because once they get that foundation, then they can build upon that foundation. But if they don't have a good foundation in math and science, then they will never gravitate towards it later on in life. And then also we need to encourage them that they can do this. So if we encourage the students at an early age that they can do the STEM and math and science, then they will more than often pursue it later on in life. And then the M is we need to mentor our students to become the future scientists, future mathematicians, future engineers, and future technologists. And so that's what I mean, we need the STEM for STEM. I saw Dr. Frazier as a great mentor because he was very personable and he knew his stuff. I mean, he was one of the best scientists here at Marshall. And being an African-American, really, that just put the icing on the cake, because if he could do it, I knew that I could do it as well. And he challenged me and he also just embraced me to just do more. He's like, don't be afraid to ask questions. Don't be afraid to, you know what you want. And don't be afraid to just ask for more work. So with that push and that challenge, I was like, I can do this. And so he encouraged me a lot, as well as, you know, he challenged me. And I just being someone on that caliber to embrace a young intern at that time, or co-op, that means a lot, because I've worked in a lot of different organizations. And sometimes people are very hesitant about helping you. And I don't know if it's because they're afraid of losing their job or being so young that I may come in and replace them. But Dr. Frazier, he wasn't like that. He was more like, okay, what do you need to do? Do you want to work with me? I mean, he just offers so many opportunities, and I'm greatly appreciative for him being very instrumental in my life, because if it wasn't for him, I don't know if I would be where I am today. I probably would, but I probably wouldn't feel as confident, I should say. He really boosted my self-esteem, boosted my self-confidence, and he was just somebody I can go talk to at any time. He was never too busy. And he's written books, he has patents. I mean, Dr. Frazier is like a genius. In my book, I think he's a genius. And to actually work with him hand in hand and to have him as my personal mentor, that really meant a lot to me. I did have mentors at home. I had a mentor, it was non-science. Her name was Felicia Buchanan Jones. And I just looked up to her because she was like the first person that I knew in my community that actually went and got an advanced degree. And once she got an advanced degree, she had a 4-point GPA. So I was like, I'm going to get my graduate degree and I'm going to get a 4.0. So I pursued PhD in physics, where I did end up with a 4.0 GPA. And I also have scientists or STEM mentors. And one is Dr. Sheila Nash Stevenson, who was actually the first African-American female to receive a PhD in physics in the state of Alabama. And when I did my first graduate co-op here at Marshall, Dr. Donald Frazier was also my mentor. So I kind of went to him back and forth for guidance as far as being a female in the science field, in the STEM field. By me going back to my hometown and talking to the students about what I do and that I grew up in that hometown, and as well now that I work for NASA, it has a very great impact on the students. I've had so many students come up to me and tell me if it wasn't for me, they would have majored in accounting or they would have majored in PE. But I have a lot of students who have come back and said, because of me, they majored in science. Actually, my niece, who's going to be a senior this year, she said she's going to major in physics. And I was like, really? I was really excited. But, you know, so I think the impact, it has challenged the students to push harder. And I think when students see that someone from their own hometown, from the same circumstances that they come from, if I can go from that small hometown or city and work for NASA, then that's giving them encouragement and hope that they can do it as well. So I've had students to go off and get their master's and PhDs in sciences, not physics, but biology. So that's a plus. Chemistry, that's a plus. And mathematics. So I think that I have impacted my community a lot. So that's why I encourage other people to go out to their own communities and give back, because when students see that you actually came from those humble grounds or from the same high school or same elementary school, that's giving them hope. Like, you know, if they can do it, I can do it too. Because a lot of students, they look at people who they cannot touch and they call them their role models. But I have to correct them. They are not their role models. They're more so like their goal models. That's a goal that they want to reach. I look at role models, somebody you can pick up the telephone and call. A role model, somebody you can actually have a one-on-one conversation where you can go by and visit them. But goal models, you know, students look at Steph Curry as a role model. They can't just call up Steph Curry and be like, hey, Steph, you know, how do I do a three-point shot? They cannot do that. But a role model like myself, they can call me. I give them my phone number. I give them my email addresses and say, hey, call me anytime. And I go home at least once a month. So I try to visit schools very frequently so they know where my parents live. So some students just stop by and it's like, hey, Dr. Ruth, you know this. Or they call me by my nickname, which I won't disclose on this setting here. But they feel comfortable and they come talk to me about things that they want to pursue and how do they go about working for NASA, how do they go about wanting to work for industries in the STEM fields. So actually I have impacting my community a lot. I'm just trying to encourage others to do it because, you know, I can't save the world, but I'm trying to. So it just takes one person at a time. And I'm just trying to be that leader and hopefully other people can just come back and give back, because I really tell them, no matter what you do in life, make sure you always come back to your stomping grounds and give back. It doesn't have to be money, because money, you use it and it's gone. But time is more valuable than money. And if you give students your time, they will remember that a whole lot more than you just giving them some money, because they're going to spend that and forget what they bought. And 20 years later, they won't even know what they did with the money. But they can recall that time you came to them and talked to them at that school, or you helped them with a math problem, or whatever problems they had, they will remember that time or that encouragement that you gave them.